Hey guys, today we're talking about a new trend, and that's the relay attack.
What I've been noticing, a lot of cars are being left out in the open. So whether people are renting basement suites, condos are on the rise, or people are using their garages for other things, there are a lot more cars up for exposure right now. Now, vehicles like my truck are not on the list as much anymore because it requires a key. Now, this particular truck, there is an immobilizer, but it's not chipped. It's based on if it turns the key properly inside the tumbler. That's why I run an aftermarket security system to double up on that. So my truck is a lot harder to steal. Remember, the way a thief works is time, and they're smart, they're clever, but there's also inherent things, they're lazy. So the more time and the more work you add to making your vehicle harder to steal, they're just going to pick another vehicle.
What is a relay attack? So when you're dealing with older vehicles like this, it was pretty much unheard of. And the way vehicles were stolen was you would hear of hot wiring a car, and then we would watch movies like Gone in 60 Seconds where they would use computers, but they still have to turn the keys and they would integrate with the vehicles, kind of along those lines. And we're going to show a remote starter of how we hotwire a car legally. And we're actually doing it because we need to trick the car thinking that the key's in the ignition when it's actually not. So what a relay attack is because so many new vehicles use proximity keys. And we've basically given ourselves, apparently keys were our first world problem. I kind of have to say it all started with the S2000 and push button start is like, oh, that's the coolest thing ever. And then everyone's like, well, it'd be really cool if I could just push the button start. Like, I know it's such a big deal for me to put the key in the ignition tumbler and turn it. I'm not going to talk about my opinion on push button start, but that's what it is. So what you have is you would have a key fob that stays in your pocket or wherever, and it emits a signal. So when you get in close proximity to the vehicle will recognize the remote and say, okay, you're the owner. I will allow you to get into the vehicle and I'll allow you to start the vehicle. What a relay attack does is it amplifies the signal from those proximity remotes, and you won't know about it, and the car will think that you are the owner and allow the thief to drive the vehicle away. Now, the first thing that we can do to prevent a relay attack is to stop it at the source. Now, you can just take out the battery out of your key fob, and that will stop a relay attack from happening. Now, there are problems when you just do this depending on the vehicle that you own. So if it's a vehicle like this, and let's say it had procs and everything, and you're able to get in, it wouldn't really matter because we have an aftermarket system on this one, so we can lock and unlock. We have our keyless, and then we would just put the key in and go to on to turn on or do our takeover when we were doing a remote starter. This is a first world problem. Now, some people say, well, I want to have two key fobs. Well, yeah, it's a first world problem. Now, the downside to this is, let's say you had an actual prox only vehicle. So let's say you had push to start. If you remove the key out of here, you can still start the vehicle, but you'll have to take the key fob every time and push it up onto here. And then if you don't have an aftermarket system, you don't have keyless entry anymore. So one thing you do is, like, in theory, if you were to put your keys into a tin box all the time, that's really far-fetched. I've seen Toyota owners saying if you push and hold it, it will take this out so you can't do the relay attack. My argument against that, though, is, are you going to remember to do that every single time? Not a lot of people are. So in my books, the best way to do it is to have a vehicle with a key. If you can still order with a key, this is what all the cops do. All the cop vehicles, if they can order with regular keys, they do. The only exception would be, I think, the Chargers right now. And then they run aftermarket systems because they're not susceptible to the relay attacks like factory is. Another easy way to prevent an attack is to relocate the OBD2. So for some vehicle applications and some tools, they can plug directly into the OBD2 and then they can bypass the factory immobilizer. Now, Fiat Chrysler has keyed in on this because there's a bunch of videos showing a Grand Cherokee, I believe, and it was easily able to be hacked. And those are one of the easiest vehicles for us to program for remote starters. So what they've done is they've put a gateway basically on 2018 and up, where it's much harder. So when I do a remote starter, I don't grab my CAN high, CAN low wires from here anymore. I have to grab them from somewhere else higher up in the vehicle. So that's one of their first points of making it harder to steal the vehicle. So what you can do as an owner is you can get these extensions and you can relocate it somewhere else in the vehicle where a thief doesn't know where to look, adding time to their theft. And then by the time, once they go over their time limit, they're more likely just to get out of the vehicle and then pick another one.
Okay, we're here working on an Audi Q7. It's a 2017 model, and this one is a bit more of an involved install as far as the remote starter goes, but it kind of is similar in how a relay attack would work, but it has very, very little range. So here we have a box, and what we do is we put in a key that's not cut. It just has the chip in it. That way, if a thief were able to find this box somehow, they can't put in the ignition tumbler and turn it. It just allows the vehicle to read it, because no one's been able to crack the code for this. It's just not worth it. So doing a key wrap is still a means of way of remote starting this vehicle. However, we do run an integration box, so we do have to talk to the CAN bus system of the vehicle. This works our hazard lights, so when the vehicle is remote started, it flashes the lights, works our locks and everything. And then we have a traditional remote starter brain over here, and this is what controls the whole setup. And we also have GPS tracking and phone control. So what happens is this gets installed around the key tumbler, and what it does is this energizes and then sends a signal up. And this is basically a very low tech way of how a relay attack would happen, and it's been around for a long time. So basically we tricked a vehicle thinking that the key is in the ignition when it's not. One of the other top ways of protecting against a relay attack is if you want to keep all the convenience and you didn't want to go do those other steps. If someone were to take the vehicle, because if they want to take the vehicle, they're going to take it, they're just going to tow it. You can have GPS tracking in there, and you can set modules like this up for geofencing. What it'll do is it'll send your phone a notification if the vehicle ever leaves the radius that you set at. So let's say you set the radius at your house. As soon as it leaves that area, it'll send hey, I'm leaving this area. I'm going to send a notification to the phone, let the owner know. The only downside to this is every time you drive away, it doesn't know that, it's going to send you the notification no matter what. But if you're concerned about those attacks, it's definitely worth getting one of these and turning that feature on. Okay, so we got everything all tucked away nicely. Everything is programmed up. So we can go ahead and test our remote starter. This is a diesel, so I do have a little bit of a delay allowing the glow plugs to warm up. So this is how a bypass is performed in the industry. Now our bypass only works during the remote start sequence. So as soon as you put your foot on the brake, the vehicle is going to shut down. Because in order to put the vehicle into gear, you have to push your foot on the brake. So it's hard, you can't steal this vehicle by using a remote starter in that sense. Like it'd be very difficult because you would have to do all these connections. But this is the proper way that we activate the vehicles without the key. This Audi A4 is the same idea, so we are using a HC3 for my data start, so it is an all-in-one. So we're using that to drive the system, and we're communicating with the CAN bus system, but in order to make it think that it has the key in the ignition, we are using a transponder coffin box, it's a slang term, coffin box, the box again. We're sending a signal up to the ignition to make it think that the key's in there. Let's go ahead and test two factory key fobs. So here I have an Audi key fob. So it looks like it kind of changes its frequency, which is good. Let's check our Toyota one. This one stays the same. Now, one thing you do is get an aftermarket system. Now, not all of them do this, some of them do, is look for something that does code hopping technology. So what happens is it always changes the frequency every time you use it. That way a thief can't steal the code or the frequency range and then use it against your vehicle. Hopefully this gave you guys some insight to what a relay attack is, ways you can combat it, and things to be aware of.